morning, everybody. Let's try that one more time. Good morning, everybody. So as some of you may realize, today is February 14th, Valentine's Day, a holiday that celebrates love. And regardless of any of our relationship status here, we are all part of the greatest love story in history, aren't we? John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." Would you please stand with us as we give this offering of worship to our wonderful God who loves us so very much.
Open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, our God in power, our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is awesome. Awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against?
Amen. God is good.
Well, you can be seated. Welcome this morning to Riverwood Church. We'd like to welcome those of you who are here on campus. You made it through 17 below to get here. Welcome. And we also welcome all of you who are watching us online at home. And if you are here with us, either here, or virtually here for the first time, or maybe one of the first times, we'd love to get to know you a little bit better, have a chance to connect with you. Kathy, if we have that slide, we don't have it. Okay, well, next Sunday we'll have a slide where you can type in the words connect to a phone number, and you can start receiving emails from us as far as updates and that sort of thing, and we can get to know you a little bit better too. What I want to really highlight this morning is that next Sunday we have a wonderful, wonderful treat coming. It's going to be in both services, both the 9 o'clock and the 10:30 service. We have Jeremiah Gamble of Theater for the Thirsty is going to be with us, and he's going to do a 40-minute play, and it's called The Rough and the Holy, and it highlights a number of people that Jesus interacted with during the course of his ministry. It's a blend of wonderful humor and learning, and so we invite you to come next Sunday, either one of the services. If you have a friend, someone you want to invite to come with, it would be great to have them here as well. One more thing I want to mention is that we have a need for people who, if you got any kind of interest at all in videography, the guy you want to talk to is Ken Exner. He's right there in the back. Wave, Ken. You're right there in the back by the camera. You can talk to Ken, or you can call the church office, or you can email Ken at kenexner@riverwoodonline.org. What we need is people who would be willing to operate the camera for our live video streams. So if you have an interest in helping out with that, Ken would love to talk with you. Let's pray as we start our morning service. Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you as we wrap up today our series on new territory. And I think about what your words say that Paul's going to be preaching to us today. How you, Lord God, as we look at our world and the uncertainties of it, Lord, your word says you go before your people. In other words, you've been there already. Where we're going, what we're going to be experiencing in 2021 and beyond, you have been there already. And as we enter into it, you go with us. Lord, encourage our hearts, strengthen us, bless us in the joy of the Holy Spirit as we worship this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come. come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I see you move, you move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. Made a way where there is no way, and I believe I see you do it again. I see you move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. Made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I see you do it again.
I see you do it again.
Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never failed me. Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never failed me yet.
Oh, you never failed me yet. You never failed me yet. You never failed me yet. Changes what you see. Try to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest.
when you don't give the mountains. I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answer as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and breath. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less.
When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. My steady hand, you are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. You are my always higher, your plans are always good. There's not a place where I go, you've not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answer as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
Good morning. Welcome to River Church. And by the way, children, you are dismissed to Promised Land. Kids Adventure, whatever it's called. And but I have a special assignment for you, though. When you go to your teacher, tell them Happy Valentine's from Pastor Paul, especially if her name is Colleen. And the other one is my sister in the Lord, too. So. This morning, as Mark mentioned, we're wrapping up the series that we began in January called New Territory, and today my subject is prepared for the journey. We're talking about a journey. The Israelites went on a journey into the Promised Land, and we're on our own journey. But to be prepared for the journey, to go on a journey, it's really important to be prepared. The motto of the Boy Scouts is be prepared. I was not a Boy Scout myself. I retired after Cub Scouts. Boy Scouts was the same night as sports, and but my son joined the Boy Scouts, and I was a Boy Scout dad. So in 2013, we made this trip to Philmont Ranch in New Mexico to backpack in the mountains. And when you're backpacking in the mountains, you know, 10,000 foot elevation, it takes some, not yet on the slide, it takes some work there of preparation. And so we trained, you know, we did 20-mile hikes at home in Cottage Grove. We hiked with packs on our backs, and gear is very important. And so we had to buy some boots, and I am forever thankful to my experienced veteran of several Philmont backpacking trips, Mark Pearson, our own Mark Pearson, the bass player, who recommended to me to get Vask boots. Vast hiking boots. We did that. They weren't the cheapest, but they were, put it this way. After our 10-day expedition in the mountains, Isaac and I, we were the only ones on our troop who had no blisters. Everybody else suffered that, but not us because we're well prepared. Now, a trip is different than a journey, too. Let's talk about that for a second. With a trip, I mean, you're going someplace to visit, and then you're going to come back, most likely. But a journey is different than that, at least in many times. A journey is where it's a one-way trip. You're going to a new home. And that is, sometimes you don't have time to prepare for that either. Our former missionary and my friend, Zulmai, he grew up in Afghanistan. And he was there. Now you can show the slide. This is Zulmai. He's in the U.S. Army now, 2 more years. And he was back for Christmas. And we were able to go and deliver gift cards for all these and Christmas presents to about 20-some immigrant families, also from Afghanistan. This family very, very recently come here. Now, most of them, they were helping our army in the war there. And so when the Taliban gained increase in strength, their families became targets. So they, through special immigrant visas, they came here for the sake of their families. But Zulmai was 5 years old when civil war broke out in Afghanistan, and his house got bombed. He lost family members in that. They had to pick up and go. And now he's 5 years old. They hiked 150 miles through the mountains, and you can show the next slide there, between Afghanistan and Pakistan. And there they landed in a refugee camp, and it was there where Zulmai met Christians for the first time who displayed the love of Jesus, and it attracted him, and he himself became a follower of Jesus and is serving Jesus today. Well, we're on a different type of journey. I mean, we're not going to a new home per se, but we're going to new territory for the kingdom of God in 2021 and beyond. And you know, sometimes when we go through a series like this, we forget why we did the series and where we started. So just let me reread the what we wrote about when we were beginning this series. It has been said that if 2020 were put to a Google review, most would give it a 1-star rating. What will 2021 be like? Not a question any of us can answer with certainty, but God holds the answers to how to live with joy and purpose in times of abundance and times of challenge. Join us as we explore how to live in Christ through new territory. So new territory, that's what we're talking about this morning. We're going to learn from the Israelites because this whole, everything we've based this on is from what their preparation to go into their new home, the promised land. And so what we're going to read as our text this morning is Deuteronomy 31, 1 through 8. And that is the words of Moses, his swan song, basically, that he addressed to Israel when on the eve of this journey into the new land. Then Moses went out and spoke these words to all Israel. I am now 120 years old, and I am no longer able to lead you. The Lord has said to me, you shall not cross the Jordan. The Lord your God himself will cross over ahead of you. He will destroy these nations before you, and you will take possession of their land. Joshua also will cross over ahead of you, as the Lord said. And the Lord will do to them what he did to Sihon and Og, the kings of the Amorites, whom he destroyed along with their land. The Lord will deliver them to you, and you must do to them all that I have commanded you. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them, for the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Then Moses summoned Joshua and said to him in the presence of all Israel, be strong and courageous. For you must go with this people into the land that the Lord swore to their forefathers to give them, and you must divide it among them as their inheritance. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Please bow with me as we pray. Lord, thank you for those words that you gave to Israel on their journey. Lord, as we embark upon this ongoing journey into 2021 and beyond, Lord, we pray you'll speak to us through them as well. We thank you that your Holy Spirit is the one who guides us into the truth. The sword of the Spirit is the word of God. We welcome his presence in each of our hearts now as we listen to your word. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Okay, so new territory. They were about to go into new territory. They weren't going into it alone, though. And I want to list here five other new things that were going with them as they went into this new territory. First off, this was a new start for them. This was not their first rodeo. You know, history has recorded some epic failures regarding journeys that were embarked upon. I mean, we all know about the Titanic, the ship that would never sink on its maiden voyage, sank in the bitterly cold waters of the North Atlantic. Or if you remember your American history, the Donner Party was a group of 87 wagon train people that set out from Missouri on the Oregon Trail for California. Well, their journey was ill-fated. They got caught in an early blizzard in the Sierra Nevada Mountains, and only 47 of the 87 made it, and we don't want to think about what happened to some of the ones who didn't make it. Well, I want to add a third failed journey of huge proportions to that, which is the Israelites themselves. Because this was not their first time when they were at the threshold of the promised land about to enter in. 40 years earlier, they had been there as well at Kadesh Barnea, which is on, that map shows that is on the southern border of the promised land in the north of Sinai. You know, they had been led out of Egypt, across the Red Sea, didn't take the shortest way to the promised land because there were Philistines there that would they'd have battles with that they weren't prepared for. So God led them through the desert, provided for them, and led them to Kadesh Barnea. And here they are, where they are you know, at the borders of the land that God promised to give them. So they do some reconnaissance. You know, they send spies, 12 spies out, one spy from each tribe. And they go into the lands to check it out, to find out what the land is like, what the people are like. And those spies spend 40 days in the land, and they come back with glowing reports about the fertility and the fruitfulness of the land. It's a land flowing with milk and honey, it was described as. But 10 of the spies brought a bad report. They said that there are strong nations living there. They have walled cities. There are some people there too, inhabitants who are of an unusually large stature. It's a nice land, but it's beyond us, they said. They discouraged the people. They said, we can't do it. And only two of the spies, Joshua and Caleb, they said, no, let's go at once. We can take this land. God is with us. Well, sadly, tragically, with huge consequences, the 10 spies won the day. The congregation, they lost their nerve. They lost their faith. They talked about stoning Moses and Aaron. And they said it would have been better for us to die in Egypt or die in the desert than for you to bring us here. And they talked about appointing a new leader to lead them back to Egypt, where they had been slaves, where they had been oppressed. They were so broken in their will. And that is known as the rebellion of Kadesh Barnea. And that they discovered something there. They discovered, well, that God is a God of second chances. God is a God of steadfast love. He forgives iniquity. He's also a God with, but he doesn't clear the guilty. On the other hand, it's a tension. Like Romans 11:22 says, note the kindness and severity of God. Because on the one hand, you see, it could have been worse. Because what you read it in Numbers 14, God was ready to be done with the Israelites. He told Moses, I've had it up to here with him. Paraphrase. I'll start over with you and build a new nation. And Moses interceded on behalf of Israel, and God relented from what he was poised to do. And he gave them, well, he would give them a second chance 40 years later. But for the next 40 years, 1 year for each day that the spies were in the land, they would wander through the desert. And that whole generation of 20 years old or older, which would be most of us, would pass away before they would have this second chance. And that's severe. That's hard. That's hard. But it could have been worse. And God was severe, but in his severity, he was kind. Because number one, he spared them. And number two, he refined them. They were ready the next time they would have the chance. So he gave them a new start. Secondly, as they were going into this new territory, it would be a new generation. See, I already mentioned, anyone 20 years older would not enter the promised land. So, you know, the veterans of the former generation, you could count on one hand who they would be and have three fingers left, because only Joshua and Caleb from that generation would enter into the promised land. And so that's why they need some encouragement, because this is a new, they're on tried. Moses says to them in verse 6, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them. The Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. A new generation. And you know, let me apply this to us too. And I wrote out, I'm just going to read this because I didn't want to say anything that was ill spoken and could be misconstrued. But I want to make a couple applications of this to our situation here at Riverwood Church. I've been around a few churches over the years, large and small, intimately, seven or eight, even in what I would call precedented or ordinary times, okay? People come and go, including sometimes people we love. Churches have front doors. Churches also have back doors. People leave churches for a variety of reasons. It happens. And you know, there's no denying the pandemic has changed the scenery a bit here, has it not? We're in the process of being refined. And now we're not the only ones, however. The pandemic has been hard on us, but it's been so to all churches. There are two different individuals that we've talked to who work with lots of different churches. Independently of each other, they've both said the same thing, that every church they know has taken a hit due to the pandemic. We have too, but we can get through it as we are strong and courageous. We shall overcome, as the song says, by the grace of God. New start, new generation. Third thing that would be new as they enter their new territory is a new leadership team. Moses, you know, he begins his address, says, I am now 120 years old, no longer able to lead you. Now, Moses had just the most phenomenal career of leading Israel. He was the guy who brought them out of Egypt squared off with Pharaoh, led them through the Red Sea, led them in the wilderness, endured opposition. Dwight Moody said about Moses, he said, Moses spent 40 years in Egypt thinking he was somebody, 40 years in the backside of the wilderness realizing he was nobody, and then 40 years seeing what God can do through a nobody. The unequaled leader Moses was. But Moses wasn't the guy for the next step, for the new territory. And that would be Joshua. He says, Moses summoned Joshua and charges him before all of the people. He says in verse 7, be strong and courageous, for you must go with this people into the land the Lord swore to your forefathers to give them, and you must divide it among them as their inheritance. They would have new leaders, and a new leader in Joshua. And this was a challenging task for Joshua. So Moses brings Joshua up to charge him in the presence of all the people. And let me make a couple of applications of this to us. I would ask you, while all of us need to be strong and courageous during challenging times, would you pray for your leaders who need a special measure of strength and courage? Pray for your elders, pray for your staff. You know, pray that we will be strong and courageous, that we will be wise and good shepherds of God's people who wait upon the Lord, who will be tenderhearted and at times when need be, thick-skinned. Pray for your leaders. And then another thing, application of this, which is that in a church like ours, there are transitions. There are transitions of staff. I mean, generally speaking, long-term pastors are good things, healthy things, but no pastor lasts forever. I mean, Pastor Paul someday will be over down the road at Cannon River Care Center. And when he's there, I hope you visit him. Bring chocolate and bring music. Jerry, never mind. And Pastor Mark will retire someday. It's going to happen. And Pastor Andrew's younger buck, he'll be pastoring a church someday on, somewhere else. These things happen. But the point for the church is that the church is ultimately Christ-centered, not pastor-centered. And God raises up new leadership to lead a church in the next eras, whenever that time happens. New territory. Fourthly, there will be new mercies. New mercies of God. You know, Moses, reminds the Israelites in verse 4 of something that already happened when they were in the wilderness. He says, the Lord will do to them, that is the new nations that in the land where you're going, the Lord will do to them what he did to Sihon and Og, the kings of the Amorites, whom he destroyed along with their land. You know, he has them look backward for a moment to see what God has already done, to remind them that he's going to do the same thing, more of the same, more victories ahead. And so let me try to do that for us. I mean, 2020, challenging year, right? But there were so many mercies of God that we experienced then that show that he was with us and will still be with us. But I mean, because our finances are healthy. We had this Christmas Eve offering that I'm still blown away by and thankful for, where we raised over $5,000 for Feed My Servant Children. We got this letter from Feed My Servant Children a couple weeks ago, and it said that your gift is providing 22,204 manna pack meals to those around the world who need it most. Every gift matters to a hungry child. You're saving lives. You're providing hope. We were able to do that for a lot of children. And I already mentioned the outreach to Afghani immigrant families at Christmas time. You know, we have these faithful and dedicated worship leaders that rehearse and lead us in worship each week, and they're doing an excellent job. This past year, we were able to launch Treehouse Ministry, which is something that's going to help reach out to youth that might fall through the cracks otherwise and provide them with a good path for their lives. Grief Share continues to bring comfort and provide hope for those who are bereaved. We are beginning the Quechua initiative on a global scale in doing the relationship building and research that will lead, Lord willing, to a partnership of ministry among the Quechua people in South America. We have a healthy elder board. This past year, people have come to faith in Christ through here. They've put their trust in Jesus. You know, we have experienced many mercies, even in a hard year. We received many mercies from God, and we'll receive more in the days ahead, because as the scripture says, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to end, and they are new every morning, because God's faithfulness is so great. We'll receive new mercies. And then fifth, they went into the new territory with new promises, and that's what we have too. To some of the two promises, God is with you and God goes before you. And God is with us too. Jesus said it to his disciples before he ascended into heaven. He said, lo, I am with you always to the end of the age. You know, the age is not ended. He's with us too as we go about our mission, our territory, advancing territory of the kingdom of God. And he goes, that means that we've got the resources we need. We've got the Holy Spirit. We have what we need to live godly lives to his glory and to be about his ministry. We've got what we need. And he goes before us too. I think we forget that he goes before us. And what does that mean? It means that we don't have to try to make this up as we go along. And we are helped as we wait upon the Lord, see where he's at work already, see who he's preparing, and join him in what he's doing. And that keeps us from the mistake of just saying, okay, I'm going to do this for God. Here's what I'm going to do. And maybe God's not in it. He doesn't bless. Here's the difference of what I'm trying to explain. I think it's a difference between Saul of Tarsus and the Apostle Paul. Because Saul of Tarsus, he loved God. He had zeal for God. But he was doing it the way he thought it should be. He was persecuting the church. He was rounding up Christians, throw them into prison, try to stomp out this cult. Then on the Damascus Road, he met Jesus. And his attitude was changed, even immediately, because Jesus was his master. Jesus was his Lord. So it's recorded that on the road, he said to Jesus, what shall I do, Lord? He didn't determine that for himself. He asked Jesus, what shall I do? And he would receive his answer not long afterwards when Ananias was sent to him with the message from God that said, he is my chosen vessel to take the gospel before kings and the Gentiles and the people of Israel. I will show him what he must suffer for my name. God has gone before us as well. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. God's gone before us. There's works for us to do. And I've been applying this whole thing to us as a church, because that's true. And it's also true for individuals. And as we join him and are strong and courageous, we face the new challenges and make the most of the new opportunities. But journey is kind of a big term, and you think of groups and journeys, and I've applied it that way. But let's talk a moment about you personally and your personal journey, your personal mission trip, if you will, because there are people around you in your life that I'm asking you to have new eyes to see them and to see and to listen to the Spirit's leading, and that maybe that's somebody that he's calling you to minister to reach out to, and to serve in Jesus' name. Let me give you one example that happened for us. In 2007, I visited Valerie, my oldest daughter, in the Philippines, where she was a Wheaton College senior, and I had spent the last 6 months there working in a village called Imogon, which is on the island of Luzon, same island as Manila, about a six-hour drive from Manila. And she got to know those people, loved them, they loved her. And I got to meet them when I was there. And one of the guys she met was at that time a two-year-old boy named Wen. And when the family honored Valerie with asking her to be godmother for Wynn, which she agreed to. Well, we lost Valerie in 2015, and you know, we received wonderful support from you, from friends in Cottage Grove. We also received lots of expressions of consolation from 8,000 miles away in the Philippines through emails, through cards. And they felt the loss, they too. And so, anyways, and then it was my wife's idea, but we thought, why don't we pick up the mantle from Valerie and be involved in Wynn's life? And so that's what we've done for the last few years. And you know, I suppose it's like sponsoring a compassion child, but through electronic bank transfers, we've been able to provide some things for them, you know, clothing, Bible, school supplies, presents, art supplies. And now he just had his 15th birthday a week or so ago, and there's some pictures of Wynn. But it's been very gratifying for us to make something good out of a bad thing and to be involved in his life. And so, you know, it doesn't have to be somebody from the other side of the world either. I mean, it can be someone that God may be calling you to from across the street, down the road, maybe, you know, in a different aisle at work or down the hall, whatever. Could be in your own family. But what I would like to challenge you to do is to go reach out as the Spirit prompts you. You know, don't just be like I've done so many times before where I get a good idea, I don't act on it. If you sense that, to reach out, take that journey, you know, of maybe a few feet. And if God's leading you to that, to be obedient, and he can use you. And when you have an opportunity like that, to be obedient, to be strong, and to be courageous, to have the courage to reach out. Would you bow with me in prayer? Lord, I thank you. Thank you that we're here. You have us here. And we're not alone. And we're not static. We're not meant to be static. We're meant to move forward, and that's what you want us to do, and we can do it. And in fact, you've gone before us, Lord. Thank you for that. And would you give us as a church body, give us as individuals that obedience, that following your leadership into new territory, into new relationships, into new ministries, into new opportunities to serve you, to make you known, to advance your kingdom. Lord, help us to be strong and courageous. We can do everything through him who gives us the strength. And we pray you'll be glorified by the new fruit that we can bear. To your honor and glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, we're singing a song. I requested, and Bethany was gracious to choose as a closing song. The one reason I did that, because there's it's one phrase that says where it says, I see a new generation rising to take its place. And we are that generation. And may we rise to take our place with selfless faith.
Please stand with us as we join in song singing.
Hosanna, Hosanna,
benediction. Some verses from Romans 15. One verse that just precedes it, I'm going to read two because it applies to what this whole series has been about. It says in verse 4, "For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope." That's what the whole series has been. And that's why, let me say, encourage you to read the Old Testament as well. Don't just be stuck in the New Testament. So much to learn. And before I give the benediction, just please, we do have Elder Don Callahan, who is available to pray with anyone, any special needs. So please take advantage of that if you would need to, like to. Okay, Romans 15, 5 and 6. "May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you a spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Christ Jesus, so that with one heart and one mouth you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen."